But they are fundraising and tracking quite well in that respect, I believe. So we've given them sufficient time to raise the funds, which is effectively what they requested. And so the sale and purchase agreement, which is conditional upon them obtaining a feasibility study, which funders require, and then having raised sufficient funds to make the purchase by the 1st of June 2016. Happy to take any questions.
Who is the chair of the Rivoli Theatre Trust?
Lois Livingston.
Right, so who do you communicate with?
I communicate with Emma Falconer, who is the lawyer that has been engaged by Rivoli Theatre to negotiate the purchase.
So she's not on the trust, she has been engaged by them?
That's correct, although she does have a long history of association with the...
Right, so she's been authorised from the trust perspective to negotiate and communicate with us, and what she says represents the trust position.
That's correct.
Okay. Good, thank you. I've got Councillor McPherson.
Yes, just following from that question, do we know that for a fact that she's been authorised in respect to that? And the reason I'm asking that is because I thought it was clear at the end of our last meeting that we wanted our staff to go and speak to the trust. Very clear. And we didn't want these toing and froings of letters. We wanted to come back with a sort of, if possible, an agreed position. And it doesn't sound like it's yet achieved. I agree, mark you, they're towards each other, but not together.
Yeah. Yes, look, they've written to us and said that, Stace Hammond Grace, just Stace Hammond now, of course. Emma Falconer has written to say that they have been engaged by Rivoli Theatre and Arts Centre Incorporated to assist with its proposed purchase of the property at 80 Rivoli Road.
Why didn't you include, this is a political issue, it's become that, I'm sure none of us wanted it. Why didn't you speak to the trust as well? We're not in the process of middle of a sale yet. We're trying to find out what should go into the sale and purchase agreement, surely?
Originally, all of our interactions were with the trust, and that was...
Who at the trust?
With Lois, principally, as their representative and spokesperson. And that was the channel of communication that we were working through. Subsequently, we received this correspondence to say that the matters would now be referred to Emma Falconer.
Okay. I've got Councillor Pascoe, then Councillor Gallagher.
Yes, thank you, Worship. My question is around, there's been, over a period of time, quite significant media coverage on the fact that the trust and perhaps the media had drawn a conclusion that Rivoli was being treated more unfairly than the Meteor or Clarence Street. Has that inference that they have been treated unfairly, has that now been sorted? Because when I read this, it seems to me like, you know, there are some similar comparisons here, and that the Rivoli has enjoyed some benefits that the other two theatres haven't got in terms of the gifts that have been made to them.
Yeah, look, I think in a sense the other theatres have been given their buildings, as was Rivoli. In the case of the Meteor and Clarence Street, there are obviously significant capital upgrades associated with that gift, and it has a revocation period, effectively, for a certain number of years. Rivoli were granted given their buildings 10 years ago, 2005. So, effectively, when it comes to the land, they're really the first cab off the rank. They're 10 years ahead of the other two theatre groups. And I would imagine that in the fullness of time, if those other two groups were successful with their ventures, they may well come to council and either initiate a sale or a gifting of that land, which of course would be a council decision at that time if that were to happen.
But my question is, do you think the Rivoli now realise that they haven't been treated unfairly in terms of the comparisons that have been made between the other two theatres, or is that matter still unresolved?
Look, I think we're getting a mixed message, which is one of the reasons why it's been a little bit difficult to navigate our way through this sale. So I think it's fair to say some members of the Rivalea family are of the view that we are not treating them fairly, but others seem to be of the view that they want the purchase to proceed.
Okay. Thank you. Councillor Gallagher?
Yes. One, obviously the board has noted that they're disappointed there was no direct communication with regard to the content of the staff report. But secondly, the issue is the last sentence, which is obviously key. Rivalea is determined to become the owner of the land and would appreciate any assistance the City Council can give towards achieving this, because they relate that to the long-term development, I think, of the site and having security to raise loan and all of that, which I get. If they don't make, is it the 2016, there's a deadline to raise the dough.
That's right.
If they don't, what is that? That's 2016? What? If they don't make, when in 2016 is it again? Sorry.
June 2016.
So, Councillor Gill, you're saying if they don't raise the money by June?
What happens? Because that's the ticking.
Well, we have a standing resolution that would suggest that we then put the property on the open market.
And that's, could I say from their point of view, do you, Glenn, that's them a crunch point for them? Because basically they do have the sword hanging over their head if they're unsuccessful in doing the adequate fundraising, amassing the money.
Yes, I think I'd make two comments. The first is that they still have tenure, because, of course, they've got a lease that binds them until 2027 at the earliest. The other point I'd make is that in terms of the agreement that we had with Rivalea in their lease agreement, they have a first right of refusal, has been activated. But in the document itself, that first right of refusal has some pretty stringent timeframes around it. And if we were to stick to that, they would have been given 20 days notice to come up with a yes-no position, and if the answer was yes, then to sign an unconditional agreement there and then. Now, we have acknowledged the fact that they don't have the cash sitting in their account, and, of course, have worked with them in order to give them sufficient time to raise those funds. Which will have amounted to some 22 months by the time we come to the actual settlement date.
But is that not the significant difference between the Meteor and Clarence? Now those groups are in a different space. They're going to spend some dough and all of that, but they don't have the actual having to front with a front end load of cash in order to secure their premises. Now I understand there's some issues around securing. If you own a premise, you know, as per the last sentence, then that gives you a lot more leeway in terms of, you know, your long-term capital running and development than perhaps the other two groups would have. But that's a critical difference, surely.
If I may, yeah, you're correct, it is. But we need to remember the timeframes. We're talking about the arrangement with Rivalea was 10 years ago, or just over 10 years ago. The arrangements that have been more recent with the Clarence Street Theatre and Meteor have been very recent. So the question, as Nicholas said, is some space, time in the future, if those two theatres find themselves in a position where they can acquire the land so they can do more on the space, so they can have more security, a better balance sheet, then that option will be open to them. And so it's difficult to equate equity, given that there's a 10-year span between the two and the state of the buildings are very, very different. I'd also stress that we have, you know, a mechanism in place where council may contribute towards building upgrade work for both the Meteor and the Clarence Street Theatre, which is around earthquake strengthening work that was recognised at the time. They still have to determine whether or not they still need to do it, given changes in earthquake and the regulations and so forth, and they have to determine what the actual price is. That money may or may not be forthcoming from council, depending on what they actually ultimately do.
So they're on the fundraiser, and the patrons John and Glenice Gallagher are hosting, and a number of councillors no doubt will be attending. This do in the next month or so. Very good that they've done that. But in the end, if they don't make, just help me here, if they don't make the time, it is entirely possible that then just floats onto the open market, surely?
Based on the resolution that was in place from 2014, yes.
Yeah. So the other thing in this letter was that they have sort of basically identified, it seems to me, and I'm a bit confused, you know, but you've had a legal, you've got their lawyer's rep, you know, rep signing an agreement, and yet the board itself is saying that they want a contribution of $100,000 be made by Councillor Flett, what has been put in place for the other venues in terms of their assessment of an apples with apples. It seems to me that, so it's a kind of a, that tells me that's a kind of a bit of a dispute around the asking price, you know, around our price that's been negotiated. Just help me through that. So you've got the board saying that they want a they would like a contribution of $100,000 that sort of evens things up, and again, that's just their view. I'm not judging the accuracy or otherwise
of that. Sorry, Councillor, what's the question
about? The question is, it's pretty obvious that they believe that they are paying 100 grand too much, or being asked to pay 100 grand too much. Sorry, Your Worship.
To be fair, they have never questioned the asking price at 460.
Right.
I think what they are saying is that other groups, i.e. The Meteor and Clarence Street entities, have received a contribution from council, and they're asking for, they're stipulating or suggesting 100,000 as a contribution from council.
So that's predicated not necessarily around a disagreement for about a price. It's more if you were treating us equally, their view, that you would make that cash.
If I may, Your Worship, just add to that question. This letter that has come through today, I just saw it briefly before the council meeting. This is the first time we've ever had that put to us. This is all new, so it's nothing that's been put to us previously. So it hasn't been a part of any of prior discussion.
Right, so I've got Councillor Mallett next.
Thank you. Just with regard to this undated, unsigned letter, what is it? I mean, we all got emailed it, but is it a resolution of their board? The Riverlea would request a contribution of 100,000. What status does it have? Has this come through the, sorry, I forgot the name of the, they have appointed an agent to represent them, is that right?
That's correct.
And this hasn't come from that agent,
no,
has
it? No,
it
hasn't.
So what, just asking some advice from someone, what do we do with this?
Well, I think council amounts the same as communications that councillors frequently receive from parties.
Well, it's not even signed, it's not dated,
no,
I don't know
well,
who
I
it's
mean,
from.
You're stating facts, so it's come via an email from Lois Livingstone. So that's the status of it. So if you want to make further inquiry, I don't know if any councillors have made further inquiry today about what the status of that is. I guess it can be regarded as any other communication that councillors frequently receive from members of the community.
Okay. So when you're dealing in your sale and purchase arrangements with the trust, the only person you deal with, what's the lady's name again?
Emma Faulkner.
Emma Faulkner, you deal with her?
Correct.
Yeah, and so she's authorised by the, and you know she's authorised properly by the trust.
Can I add to that point, councillors, through you, Your Worship? I received.
You don't know who you're talking to half the time.
I received an email on the 4th of July from Lois Livingstone, and I actually did circulate this to council where I was copied in on that email, and it notes in here that I'll read it. we're hoping to move on from this with our lawyer, Emma Faulkner, being the conduit for any further contact with council. So that was in relation to the transaction. So that was reinforced later on by a letter that was received by Nicholas in terms of Emma being representative of the council in terms of the sale and purchase of that property.
Okay, so just to clarify for councillor's benefit, the chair of the board wrote to you and said that Emma is the person that has got the authority to act for the board.
It was an email not addressed to me, I was copied into that email.
Who was it sent?
It was sent to Bridget Wells. And I forwarded that email to councillors.
Right.
So this is this hasn't come through that lady that hit from Mrs. Faulkner.
Could I just record that I didn't receive that email today?
About 12 o'clock.
Yeah, no, I didn't get that.
All right. So I've got Councillor Wilson. You've got something.
Yeah, just just very quickly.
Just on. Could you put your mic on, thanks?
Sure. Let me turn this over. How's that? Is that better?
No. In fact, I think I was. Your worship. Just in regards to this comparison between the other theatre groups and Rivoli, am I correct Rivoli is unique in the sense that unlike the others, if they purchased the land, in theory there are no constraints by council in terms of their ability to use the either the improvements on the land or the land as an asset to underpin any borrowings?
That's correct, and that's the advantage to them for the purchase.
Is it also true that, in fact, they are the only party that could actually derive the full benefit of the entire transaction because they currently own the improvements?
That's correct.
So I think it, on the face of it, seems incredibly churlish to, from their position, to compare themselves with the other party and say, hey, we haven't had a fair deal. It's probably not a fair question. Let me...
It's not really a question, is it?
No.
You can make your own. You can make up your own mind about that.
Finally, of course, all of the subsequent correspondence that we've received is post a duly exercised and signed sale and purchase agreement.
There's no sign from them. So we've received from Rivoli two signed sale and purchase agreements.
Conditional.
The first one was the one I mentioned last time we discussed this matter, and the problem with that was that the dates didn't align. So on that particular document, their final date for settlement was outside. Sorry, their final date for satisfaction of one of their finance clauses was beyond the settlement date, which had been agreed between council and staff and Rivoli. So that one was returned to them unexecuted by council, and we've subsequently received a new agreement back, which has the date aligned, so still has the finance clauses in it, but the finance clause is settled goes unconditional on the 1st of June. Now, that particular agreement has been signed by the representatives of the Rivoli Board, Lois Livingston and Jean Greedy, and awaits our execution. I would just make one...
At the same year?
2016.
Yep, thank you. And at the same price?
At the same price.
Correct. And so why haven't we signed it?
Well, we brought it back for approval, basically.
Councillor Wilson, we did ask for this report to come to the council, so...
Right.
Yeah.
Although it is true to say that the existing resolution would have given us the authority, but given the obviously high political interest in this matter, we wanted to refer it back to you first.
Thank you.
Sorry, there is one other point
I'd
just like to make. In the letter I received from Emma Faulkner, the lawyer acting for Rivoli, she says in her very last paragraph, Rivoli asks for the negotiations for the purchase of the land to continue if financial assistance by council is deemed appropriate as a result of council's report. This can be addressed as a separate issue to the negotiations for the purchase. So I think what she's signalling there is that should council choose to grant some kind of concession, then she would like that dealt with separate to the main sale and purchase discussion. She doesn't want that discussion to be derailed.
Okay, thank you. Deputy Mayor?
Yes, thanks, Your Worship. To Nicholas and Sean, are we making this more difficult than it should be?
I think dealing with committees is generally more difficult than...
Because I wonder however that answer comes out, whether the land under the Rivoli Theatre should just simply be removed from sale. And so that would mean, surely, that we would not be putting the Rivoli Trust under stress and pressure to achieve a sale outcome, which if they don't do it, I presume we would just simply sell on the open market. Would it be true that if we removed the land for sale and assured them the occupancy through to 2032, that they would be treated equally with the other two theatre groups? Because the conversation surely has been turned around by outcomes for the other two theatre groups when this was one of the earlier discussions. So I just wonder, are we making it too difficult for ourselves?
I think there is a
first right of refusal requirement, though, isn't there?
There is. And I think they have a genuine desire to purchase. I mean, the correspondence I've received from their lawyer says that they are committed to the sale, to the purchase of the property, but they require some time in order to get their funding aligned. And they go on to say that they believe that it's the opinion of Rivoli that it is in the best interests of both Rivoli and the societies which use Rivoli Theatre that certainty of tenure is obtained as soon as possible and that the land purchase proceed. And I mean, even given the perhaps ambiguous status of this email we received today, the bottom line still says Rivoli is determined to become the owner of the land and would appreciate any assistance.
So I think the next question, Your Worship, is that I heard you reply, I think, to Councillor Mallett, that the value of the land currently is like 50% discount. Would you be creating a precedent if they agreed and paid $460,000? Would you then feel compelled to offer Meteor and Clarence Street Theatre the same 50% deal on their properties?
It's important to realise that it's not a discount. That is the current market value of the land while the lease is in place.
And that's based on that lease through to 2032.
Correct. So it's
I appreciate the leases are correct on Meteor and Clarence Street are, I think, 3 years. Is that correct?
No, the
situation with Clarence and Meteor are that they are a building, they're a gift on the building. There is no lease that's attached to our land ownership. If further down the track we were to look to sell either the land or those two theatre companies were wanting to purchase the land, the valuation would be done on it based on their occupation or ability to occupy the site by virtue of having the ownership of the building. And that valuation would be whatever it would be, but it would be highly discounted, just as the valuation that Nicholas has talked about for Rivoli is highly discounted because of the existing leasehold that is held by Rivoli.
But equally, if Rivoli bought the land and they had that 50% discount, surely they could at some point in the future sell and realise the full market value and move elsewhere. Wouldn't that be true for Clarence and the Meteor?
Potentially, yes. But the point that you raise about Rivoli is exactly right, and it is certainly what we discussed in November last year when we had the original resolution go through, that there is a financial advantage to the Rivoli Theatre here through this transaction.
So would it be true that one of the major differences is that Clarence Street and Meteor are on a trial basis, Rivoli has been going for a longer period and therefore has an established business? So my real question is, what would stop us from removing the land from sale and assuring them, which is what they said in the letter, they wanted, which was a surety around their occupancy?
They have certainty on their occupancy on the terms of the existing lease, which goes out until 2027. So they have tenure. But in our early discussions with the Trust, one of the issues, and we discussed this in November last year, that they had, was that they do want to do some fairly significant improvements to the site. Their challenges in terms of upgrading the building and raising substantial amount of money for the site is that they need tenure of the land to help them actually achieve that. They need certainty of how long the land is theirs to use. They need tenure that will help them with the financing and so forth. So the discussions that we had very early on in the piece, you could see there was definitely a leaning that they understood that there was value in them having an ownership opportunity.
Would it be true that we pressured them, if you like, by our decision to sell the assets to respond to our earlier decision?
I think that's correct. We have put pressure on them in terms of advancing the matter. As I've said previously, the matter has been advanced for a number of years now. That's not new. However, we are taking action on it as a result of last year's resolution.
So Your Worship, correct. I would probably be prepared to signal a resolution, but I'd need advice from our corporate services because of the previous resolution. Did you want me to signal what that might
be? Well, why don't you sort of work out what you want to say on that? Because
well, I do have that.
Okay, so do you want to... so this is going to be a motion, is it?
So I'm probably going to move if there is support that the land under the Rivoli Theatre be removed from sale and that the Rivoli Theatre Trust be advised and the Trust is assured of certainty of occupancy through the period of the lease to 2032. But that's in direct contradiction to the resolution. That's where I need some advice.
Right, so you can sort that out. Well, I'm just going to go... I've got some more questions here, so why don't you sort out what the wording's got to be, OK? Councillor McPherson, you've got questions, and I've got Councillor O'Leary.
Yes, thank you, Worship. Firstly, a question to the Chief Executive through you. Yes, it can. Would you not say that we're... And I'm sort of with the Deputy Mayor's first statement here, that we're perhaps handling this now, not our fault, but the way things have turned out the wrong way, in the sense we have our property division dealing with it because of an earlier resolution of council, when in actual fact it is a political issue that needs some higher level heads of agreement sorted out before we deliver it to the technical people to handle up, to sign off on the final deals?
So we're effectively operating under a resolution of council, and that, and the resolution of council was to proceed with initially the first right offer to Rivoli Theatre and then subsequently open market, and that's what the property team do. So this is the right team based on that resolution. If council makes another resolution that revokes that resolution for another course of action, I'll put the right team involved to do that work.
Which, if it did, for instance, revoke... follow the Deputy Mayor's suggestion at this stage, which may be a resolution, you would not have the property team dealing with it in the first instance.
Oh, depending on what the resolution is, if it's to extend the lease.
Well, you've heard what the resolution is, that it's been removed from sale. The wording can... I'm trying to find out whether we're handling this the right way, whether you think there might be a better way of handling it. I appreciate that we... And I said this at the start... There is a resolution on the table, which is why they're handling it.
So
I'm asking if there's a better way to handle it. Advice from the CEO.
I need. Unfortunately, I was seeking advice from Democracy when the Deputy Mayor was mentioning the resolution, so I didn't hear it.
What the Deputy Mayor is proposing is that there isn't a sale. So, in light of that, Councillor McPherson's question is in light of that...
Should we be looking for a political/CEO-level approach to sort out the best way forward, get agreement from their trust, their political side, and then come back to council with legal documents that reflect that agreement? At the moment, we're trying to juggle the wording of legal documents to suit political... needs as perceived around this table and around their trust board, instead of getting the political agreement first and then having the legal documents reflect that.
And when you are talking about agreement, are you talking about whether there is a purchase or not?
That's whether there's a purchase or not, but it's also an assumption, Your Worship, that the last sentence in Lois's letter is still the position that they would like to buy it and we would like to sell it, but while it's on the table... The sale is on the table. With the wording we've got, it makes it difficult for either party to move to actually completely align themselves.
So you clear on that? Just have you got the right team?
Yeah, Worship, I believe I have the right team.
So, Your Worship, right, okay. Just technically...
Well, that's why it's taken so long.
Quiet. Look, there's four people...
And I hadn't finished.
At the moment.
That was at a second.
Four people.
Second question. The Chief Executive said it's being handled best way.
Just be quiet a moment while I tell the other three people to be quiet.
Sorry. Be quiet, Ewan.
I can see you all. Councillor McPherson the is second finishing question. His question to you.
Yeah, I did. He finished his answer to that. He thinks it's being handled the best way. The second question relates to your comparisons. Is it... I mean, I'm looking at the list of things that have been given to each of the three theatres, money and so forth. Aren't you missing a very large allocation that this council made to the Clarence Street Theatre in the early 2000s? I think it was either $600,000 or $800,000, somewhere in that order, because it had fallen in a hole and was about to... I thought it was going to be repossessed or something dire was going to happen. If we're talking about the amount of money that's been put in...
Trust Bank mortgage...
Thanks, Gordon.
It was the repayment of a debt.
Yeah. Yeah, so shouldn't that be on the table to compare apples with apples?
Shouldn't that have been included in your summary?
Look, if I may, the history of that is actually quite a bit greater than what you're suggesting, and over a much longer period of time, as I understand it. However, it was with a very different organisation. Yes, it was the same building, but it was not with the same organisation that has recently received the gift of the Clarence Street Theatre.
Okay, but so the purpose of our work with those the three theatres, has it not been to try and enable them to stand on their own feet and minimise the risk and the ongoing costs to council?
That's correct. And in the case of Riverlea Theatre, I'm assuming that's what was achieved 10 years ago. I don't know that there was an ongoing operating risk at the time for council, but certainly they received the gift of the building at the time. To enable them to operate it, and they've survived the threshold. They've broken through that barrier of time.
So would it have been easier if maybe for us to have a policy across the board for the three theatres, and it's a little bit after the event, that sort of said, this is what we're trying to achieve, something similar, obviously slightly different in each case, different trusts, different buildings, but something similar, high level, this is where we're heading for each of them. We want them all to be independent as possible while we're sort of ensuring they don't fall over and they can keep delivering theatre services.
Look, if I may, Your Worship, just I don't know that it's that easy to get an exact equitability between the different entities and how many entities do you then entertain looking after and so forth, because bearing in mind the One Victoria Trust is a brand new entity, the Clarence Street Theatre Trust is a brand new entity, and so forth. So it would be difficult to try and do the equity. If I could just make a statement, if you don't mind, we have had assurances from the Riverlea Theatre Trust that they want to buy the property. They have been clear that they're struggling and need time, and we have given them way, way, way more time than we normally would with a property transaction, and still intend to do so by suggesting we go out as far as June 2016. We have a letter from their lawyer saying that they are determined to purchase it. We have a signed sale and purchase agreement from them. And the letter today that came in also reaffirmed that they wish to purchase this. I'm struggling, I'm sorry, and I apologise if you take this the wrong way, I'm struggling to find why we feel there's a complication here.
And just to confirm, the sale and purchase agreement has been signed by the trust chair, which is Lois.
That's right.
Right. Yes, I can see everyone's hands, which is a good sign. I've got Councillor Leary next. Okay. Then I've got the Deputy Mayor, and then I've got Councillor Forsyth. Right.
And thank you.
I didn't see you, Councillor Gallagher, which is quite surprising.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. I just on your last comment, Sean, and something you said earlier.
And we are on questions, aren't we?
Yes. I always manage a question, Your Worship.
Good. Hope. Yes. Right.
You said that... look, I'm struggling as well with the statements around, look, they want to purchase, and they're telling us they want to purchase, but they want to do that because we've shifted the goalposts on them and we've put the land for sale. So the argument has changed. The conversation has changed. Initially, at the beginning, wasn't it? They didn't want to purchase because they said they couldn't. They didn't have any money. Is that right?
No, they've never actually said they didn't want to purchase. What they've said is they have... We've been getting two sort of parallel messages. The first is that they want to continue negotiating the purchase at the price, but they needed time to raise the purchase funds. That's one message. The other is this parity with the other two theatres and whether or not they should be gifted the land. And those two arguments seem to have been trucking in parallel, which has made it quite confusing at times, hence the to-ing and fro-ing of communication and meetings and referrals back to committees and so forth and so on, to get clarity around what exactly is being discussed in a given moment.
So your involvement only started, though, when the council put the resolution to sell the land, is that correct?
That's correct.
Yeah, okay. So just following on from the Deputy Mayor proposing his amendment, we could also remove the land for sale, remove the lease, and enter, I guess, into an agreement the same as the Meteor and Clarence Street, which would be basically a perpetual occupancy, like a memorandum of understanding. We could also go a step further than what the Deputy Mayor's suggesting, couldn't we? And if we did that, have they expressed at the beginning of these conversations, have they expressed that would be the perfect scenario?
No, they haven't. They haven't said that. I think that the prize for Rivoli is that they're getting an asset for half price.
I get that.
And that is a real tangible benefit for this organisation, because effectively they lay out $460,000 and immediately get an asset worth close to $1 million, which they could then sell the next day.
Okay, I've now got the Deputy Mayor.
Yes, thanks, Your Worship. So can I just ask you about what is for sale? On page 57, there is the map of the site.
It's the area bordered in
the
red.
The area in yellow, is that the site for lease, or does it include the other bit of land in the red border? Is it the total land area?
It is the total area bordered in red, yes.
So would, if the mood of council was to not to sell and go back to status quo, could council consider selling off that smaller block of land because it's a road frontage and ensure that, or couldn't they do that because the trust has the lease until 2032? So do we have control over that red bit of land?
We have control over the blue bit of land. So yes is the answer to your question.
So that would be true that if it were the mood of council, we could not sell the land and we could sell the blue bit.
Correct.
Which would have considerable commercial value because of its location. How big is that piece of land?
Look, I don't know the exact area. But we could. We would have to subdivide. There'd be some upfront costs for that, and then we'd have to place it on the open market. We've looked at whether or not it would be advantageous to divide that land into, say, two lots or one lot. The advice we've received is one lot. Advice we've also received is that the demand for a section of that size in that location would not be great, and therefore we'd have some holding costs potentially while land sat on the open market.
Right, Councillor Forsyth.
Thank you. What's the zoning of that piece of blue land?
It's industrial.
So theoretically, what does that mean? A bitumen factory could be put there?
Look, I think the answer to that's probably correct. If you look at some of the other industries that are immediately around it, there's steel foundries and prefabrication factories and so forth, so yes.
And they'd be quite within their rights to do that right next door to Rivoli Theatre.
Correct.
Can you just remind me, please, what the process has been to get us, council, to make the decision thus far to sell Rivoli? Didn't we undergo a theatres review, all that kind of thing?
The theatres review was very specific to the theatres that we were owning and operating at the time, so Clarence Street, the Meteor and Founders Theatre. We did, however, take into consideration Rivoli Theatre as an operation and the organisations that make up what Rivoli Theatre is as a part of the overall theatres review, yes. The direction of travel, however, to sell the land at Rivoli was not necessarily linked to the theatres review itself. That was already something that was mooted for consideration under the long-term plan. So, yes, we considered the operation of the Rivoli Theatre and the direction of travel of Rivoli and had discussions with the people at Rivoli as a part of the theatre's review, but the theatre's review was not the driver of the question over the sale of land.
So can you remind me then what was the conclusion regarding Rivoli, excluding this next position that we talk about, the sale of the land?
Are you saying with regards to the theatre's
review?
Well, basically it was an acknowledgement that the Rivoli Theatre organisation and the various performance groups that use the venue are operating extremely well, and they're quite self-sufficient, and they've cracked the model. They've done an extremely good job. We did talk, as I said last month, to them about whether or not they could work with other parties that had an interest with Clarence Street and the Meteor Theatre. And we got them together. We facilitated a number of a couple of meetings and so forth, but they decided that they wanted to really stay quite contained within their existing operation at River Lea. And it was actually during those discussions that we became aware of their ambitions to actually do in a longer-term plan sense, or, you know, a longer-term sense, you know, significant upgrades to the building and the facility on the land, and their concerns that they didn't have tenure of the land and certainty of, you know, beyond the lease and things like that. So that's how we became aware of through those discussions.
So it would be fair to say then that purchasing the land would give them, I mean, that's obvious, I presume, one of the reasons why they're keen to purchase the land, it gives them control over the buildings, et cetera, et cetera. So can you, again, if we go back to the theatre's review, we've made decisions around Clarence Street and the Meteor. So what was the outcome of those? What was the direction that was indicated by the theatre's review around those two facilities?
For the Meteor and Clarence Street, quite simply, we continue to own the land. The buildings were gifted to the two respective trusts. They take on a right to basically occupy and operate in those buildings. They take on full responsibility to maintain them to an appropriate standard and operate the theatre operations to an agreed level. There's some key performance indicators that were part of the deed and so forth. So they obviously have to reach a sort of a threshold and be able to put it frank, survive financially for a certain number of years before that becomes a permanent basis arrangement. But the land remains under the ownership of council.
Council, but we gifted them the facility.
The buildings.
And in this case, we own the land still? Correct. At this point?
At this point, correct.
But the facility is owned by River Lea?
Oh, in the case of River Lea, they own the building. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Gallagher.
The question is simple. We've had a letter today from the board, which we assume, you know, obviously from the trust board communication. They want to become the owner of the land. That's the aspiration. The dispute is around the chance that if they don't raise the money in time, then the sword falls, right?
In terms of the current resolution that's in place?
Yes. And then the second point of disagreement is whether or not council should make a contribution of a quantum of up to 100,000 to be sort of equal with the others. But that's a point of negotiation, of discussion. But the prime point is they don't want to lose they don't want to see a situation where the land under them transfers into non-council ownership unless they themselves have purchased as a trust, right?
I think that's a very real concern for them, yes.
So basically what the council presumably wants to do would be wanted to leave that option open in this, you know, in this still leave that option open, but the fear they have is they don't make that deadline, they lose the land under them.
Correct.
So to assist the Deputy Mayor, it would seem to me that the key motion of this council should be to remove that fear, right? Then some other, there's the detail then follows. It's that's their key issue of concern, surely.
Yes, I think that's correct, Councillor. I think the question to consider, however, is that if we believe that everything they tell us they want to have ownership of the land, if we believe that's what they want, and we believe that we want to sell the land and sell them to that, you still have to bind it by time. We can't have an arrangement in place that will go on forever or indefinitely. We need to bind time, and the arrangement that we have currently in place with their signed sale and purchase agreement that they presented to us has effectively given them 2 years.
But if the time ran out, what's the mechanism that it would automatically come back into this council, picking up Councillor McPherson's point, you know, that it comes to this council, not the administrative decision to put it on the open market?
Well, once again, as I said last month when we discussed this, the resolution does authorise delegate authority to the CE to then proceed to a private sector sale. However, I did make it very clear to you that if there were, if it were to fall over, we would absolutely come back to this council because of the topical interest.
Right. Yep. Good.
Well, yes, but would that not be helpful to indicate that that, I mean, to me, that, that delegation surely should just be simply removed? Just, it, you know, it's not, we understand you're going to do that. It's a clear public statement that we're removing any delegation to you, full stop, and that if this deal falls over, it just comes back to council.
Yeah, so that can be included if you
absolutely
want to make some changes. Councillor King, I've got you next, and Councillor Mallett.
I'd like to move the staff recommendations.
So we've got a motion, so you're going to do an amendment, right? Thanks for signalling that. Councillor Mallett, have you got some questions?
And just two real quick questions, and they were triggered by what
we'll
Martin was saying. Martin kept on saying that if the sale falls over, they lose it. When does the, just from, it's 2026?
2027, and then with a right of renewal for a further 5 years.
At their discretion?
Correct.
So they've actually got it till
32.
Yeah, 32. So the land's theirs till 32. Well, it's not theirs. It's theirs, yes, under a lease to 3,000.
Under lease until that point in time. And that remains in place if, for example, the land was sold to a private
If it was sold to anyone, yeah. They would be bought, sold with correct the lease intact. Yeah.
Which is the main condition on the price.
Exactly, which keeps the price down, yeah.
Will Your Worship, I'll second the amendment.
Did you have a question, Councillor Toomen?
When you look at page 25, that area which is shown as sort of a green paddock next door, in the northern part of it, which the trust has, appears to be a car park. Would that be correct, with the yellow around it?
Correct.
If that was sort of... what would that piece of land be worth on the open market if it was sold, approximately?
Look, we wouldn't be able to answer that question for you right now. I think you need to bear in mind that the theatre will require a certain amount of car park space in terms of its ability to operate in the fashion that they do at this stage. It's probably unwise for me to say this, but I've got a feeling that the Trust actually do earn some income off that through leasing car park space during the working week.
And according to my calculations, currently they're getting all that piece of land there for $2.86 per week. Would that be correct?
Right, now I've got a motion from the Deputy Mayor and an amendment from Councillor King, so I just want to get those on the board. Who's? And I'll just see who's seconding your motion, Deputy Mayor? Or do we need to put it up?
No, I don't know, I haven't canvassed that.
And I think Councillor Forsyth signalled she was going to second the amendment, which is the staff recommendation. That's correct, Councillor King? Your amendment's the staff recommendation?
Yeah.
And Councillor Forsyth seconding that?
Just in respect of the Deputy Mayor's motion, B is probably a redundant comment in that they do have a surety until the end of the lease, regardless, anyway.
Yeah, so Deputy Mayor, B's not required, is that... Okay with you? I mean, they've got a lease.
So there's no seconder for that. So
No. B, they've got a lease. The CE is saying you don't need that.
Yep.
So it's just A. Is there a seconder for that? Is there a seconder for that motion?
Yes. Yeah.
Who? Sorry, Councillor McPherson. Right.
Point of order.
What's that?
3.7.9, direct negative.
No, they've spent the last 20 minutes discussing that.
I've offered it to them for sale and now we're taking it off.
So can I have...
negative.
I mean, that's why I said go and sort that out. So I'm assuming it's up there because you've sorted that out.
Yes, Your Worship, because staff have brought a report back to council for consideration, you are able to... make a decision even though it goes against completely a previous recommendation, a staff council resolution.
Right, okay. So does that satisfy your point of order, Councillor King?
Can I have some clarification as to where it says that in the under
3.8.4.
Okay, thank you. So we've got a motion from the Deputy Mayor, seconded by Councillor McPherson, and then we've got the amendment. So I'm just checking with all of those people, what we've got up there, right? Yes. Okay.
So can I ask a question?
Yes.
A procedural question, and whether or not the, either the motion mover or probably the amendment would be that basically the critical thing is removing the delegation to staff of going on and then putting that land onto the open market if they fail to meet that particular deadline. And where would you put that if that was an option? In other words, it's clear to me they still want to buy the land. I think that's the board said that they want to buy the land. There may be some dispute around price, but they're deeply worried that they may run out of time.
So sorry, you're asking the mover of the amendment to make a change to the amendment.
Well, I'm just wondering whether, in fact, there would be a C that should the time span, you know, should the time lapse. The matter be referred back to council, and then that's the sort of the higher level rather than just I know
King?
The staff have said we'd do
Councillor
that anyway,
King,
but that would be a clear
Councillor
statement.
Councillor Gill is asking whether you would include that if the time does lapse, that it then be brought back to council for further direction.
No, I think staff have indicated that they need a timeline on this to wrap this up, yeah. And I also think that staff have said to us that they would come back to us anyway.
But why don't we state that? I mean, I'm just, without wanting to argue across the table, is just basically all we're doing is we're removing their delegated authority. We're clearly stating we're not contemplating at all to put it on the open market. What we want is to come to an agreement where they get the land, but we're not going to put it out on. If they fail the timeline, we're not going to put it onto the open market.
Because to complete a property sale, I think there needs to be some pressure, and we take that pressure away, we'll be back here in another year's time.
All right, so
getting another year's extension.
So Councillor Gill, know that the mover is not prepared to make that change. Okay. Right. So I think we're all good to go now. So I'm going to go to the mover of the motion. Do you want to speak to the motion?
The only comment I'd like to make, Your Worship, is we're actually doing a negotiation around this chamber without involving the trust, because the trust may come back and say, look, 465, we'll give you 380, which balances up maybe money that you've given to Meteor and Clarence Theatre.
Deputy Mayor, I just wanted to check there, just a correction. We have received a signed sale and purchase agreement for the price.
That's correct.
So there's no negotiation on the price. Mm. It's received.
Is it a conditional offer based on them raising the money by June next year?
The condition is to firstly obtain a feasibility study for the proposed purchase as appropriate to meet the requirements of grant applications by the 1st of September 2015. And the other condition is obtaining sufficient funding by way of grants and other applications to complete the purchase of the property by the 1st of May 2016.
Okay. Right. So the second, Your Worship, the second condition actually makes it a conditional agreement, which, picking up on Andrew King's point, delays it for a further year. Under the motion from myself and Councillor McPherson, there's still freedom for the trust to come back later. We're withdrawing it from sale, halting the pressure and the process, but it's still open and we're not directing them in any way because we don't know. I have tried to reach Lois to get a view on it and no response yet, but we are having a discussion without hearing the other side of it. So at least by withdrawing the land, we remove the pressure and there may still be another debate come forward.
Okay, thank you. Any other speakers for or against? Now, Councillor King.
I think we need certainty here. Once this offer goes through, there's going to be a 10% deposit that changes hands, which is non-refundable. That puts some pressure on straight away. The CV on this Rivalea Theatre, I imagine, is around double what we're selling it to them for. The government valuation will be around $1 million, I imagine. They're buying it for $1 million because that's all it's worth, because they've got a very long-term lease on it. That's good business on their part. They could sell the paddock in behind for probably close to what they're paying for it total. In my opinion, they're a willing buyer. They have always said they're really keen to buy this. They have substantial connected people in their group, and I believe that they've probably got a substantial amount of money from the fundraising they've been doing already. I totally understand Lois putting forward this request. Good on her. She's just trying to do the best she can in a short time frame in her response today, just before this meeting. So she's just trying. We shouldn't hold it against her. I think we need to put personalities aside here. And I think we need to give Rivoli Theatre certainty. We said we'd sell it to them. They've started fundraising. There's an offer on the table. Let's give them certainty. They've asked for a year. I think that's reasonable that we've done that in this case for a charitable trust who we've partnered with up until now. Once the sale does go through, our liabilities on this property have gone. So I'd urge you to vote for the amendment and against the motion.
Thank you. Councillor McPherson?
Yes. Look, I think that this whole process has got incredibly messy. I think inadvertently, not through design, we have driven that messiness by putting the deadlines on, extending them, arguing every time it's been brought up around this table. Just as the Deputy Mayor said, we've been handling our side of the negotiations by discussion around this table, which is a very messy way to do it. I think if we withdraw it from sale, we allow things to happen in a more measured way, not constrained by a resolution that was put forward with all good intent a few months ago, which has not been quite what we needed to do in that circumstance. I do, certainly by withdrawing from sale now, does not mean that it's not going to be sold to Rivoli, does not mean that they don't want to buy it, but it removes some of the boundaries that have been artificially put in place. And I think it's important that we do that so we can get a better outcome for all. I don't oppose the thoughts of Councillor King, for instance, in putting forward his amendment there, which was, the original staff recommendation, more or less. But I think that that still has artificial constraints that'll make it more difficult to get a measured outcome that both parties can live with. I don't think the withdrawal from sale is going to actually prevent it being sold necessarily by June the 1st or whatever that date was in June next year. I simply think that it's going to free both parties up to get a better outcome. I think you can see what results. We're having backwards and forwards negotiations. We don't know who's speaking for whom. And from their point of view, if they were listening to this debate, would they be saying, well, is it the property division speaking for council, or is it the councillors around the table? Just like we're saying, is it Lois? Is it the lawyer? Is it someone else speaking for the trust out there? It's got messy. Let's remove our side of the messiness and see if we can, with the good offices of the Chief Executive, help it get to a better outcome, rather than saying it's an entirely illegal process, because it's not.
Your Worship, sorry, Lois has advised me the Board is adamant they want to purchase. Yeah.
They want?
They want to purchase. So on that basis, I'll support the amendment, I think.
God, why didn't you tell me before I spoke?
I only just got the message, David, you're in full stream.
Okay, so you're withdrawing. Okay, to stop. So, sorry.
Can we take a text in a meeting like this as being? I'm not saying it's not valid.
No. Sorry, I think you're misinterpreting, Councillor King. If the Deputy Mayor is reconsidering whether he wants to support his own motion, he can signal that. And I'm going to check with the Democracy Manager whether during a debate you can withdraw a motion.
It's not one of those art auctions.
I think we've had this scenario previously, and I'll get ready to check that.
She just sent an email.
She must be watching on TV.
One of those Paris art auctions, you know.
Poor sad lady like you in the airport.
A bit from the other side of the world.
Councillor King, it doesn't. I mean, people often reflect during debate on whether, in fact, they do actually support their own argument.
Some of them do.
Quite right, Councillor McPherson. Sometimes they're not clear what their argument is during the debate. Quite right. And I'm just clarifying what the position is.
Okay, we're looking at standing orders 3.7.5, the withdrawal of motions and amendments. Once motions or amendments have been seconded and put to the meeting by the chairperson, they cannot be withdrawn without the consent of the majority of the members present and voting.
Right, okay, so there we go. That clarifies it. It's up. Okay, Councillor Mallett?
So presumably you just don't vote for it.
That's
correct. Anyway, okay. I was very interested to hear Dave and his concerns about messy meetings, because I think he's talking about the only other way you can do it is have secret meetings. What we are doing here is the messy, ugly, revolting process of making sausages.
So I'm glad
which is
you're
what politics is all about.
Supporting making the CEO meetings, CCO meetings totally open, Gary.
Well, they are. A lot of people are speaking on behalf of the Trust, and that's fantastic, and they deserve a voice. But I support Andrew's motion, amendment, because it also has some small assistance to the ratepayer, because the any sales proceeds will be used to pay off debt. So I will be supporting the I think it's still the amendment, isn't it?
It's the amendment. That's right. Councillor Paulson.
Yeah, just quickly, look, even despite the last-minute email, I think it's just a prime example of what happens when there are too many chiefs and not enough Indians, too many people trying to have a say instead of following the correct process. The official line of communication, as has been indicated to the CEO through the Trust, is that it's through the lawyer. The lawyer has said they're willing to purchase. So our resolution has looked to accommodate, so we just stick to the program. That's what process is all about, so it doesn't get messy and mixed up and everybody wanting to have a say when half people know what's going on and the other people don't want to know what's going on, so we keep it simple.
Okay, Councillor Wilson.
Your Worship, I find myself having to disagree with my very good friend Councillor McPherson and my equally good friend Councillor Gallagher. I don't believe there's any confusion. I don't think there's any confusion as to the material facts, nor are there any confusion as to price. I think they are very clear, and they are reflected in a perfectly constituted and signed sale and purchase agreement that's sitting in front of us to sign and send back. The only time that any confusion has been raised is in this debating chamber, in the spirit of trying to create some debate and some confusion. And I'm frequently on the same side of McPherson, and I can see the trademarks of this strategy. I recognise it, and I frequently endorse it. But on this time, I'm on the other side.
Frequently
we're on
started.
Your side now.
This is a good deal for the Rivoli Theatre Group. An incredibly good deal. Now, I accept that if I was sitting in the shoes of the chairperson of the Trust, I too would like to try to make an even a better deal. But I note that this other little bit of documentation that has arrived today is not consistent with the sales and purchase agreement. And I think it's simply there to enable some people around this debating chamber to raise the spectre of uncertainty, to get it thrown out, and so that we can continue to have this asset and not bring it to its closure. And I think that would be unfortunate. The proposal's a good one. Both parties want to action it. Let's do it. Let's get on with it. And that's why I'm supporting the amendment.
Thank you, Councillor Wilson. Any other... Yes, Councillor Gallagher.
Thank you. It is my understanding that the Chair of the Trust says that the Board is adamant they want to purchase. It is my further understanding she has said funders are not confident on funding improvements without the land now. We are in a difficult position. I will not be opposing the King Forsyth motion, and I will publicly accept the public assurance of the Chief Executive whom I employ, or we employ, that should that particular deadline not be met, then this matter would be referred back to the Council. I would also be pressing in a different forum for looking at ways in which we can ensure that the ongoing assistance we give Rivoli as a wonderful, vibrant performing arts group is consistent with the other wonderful, vibrant performing arts groups that we give support and sustenance to. And people can talk about due process and proper process. The only motive of the Deputy Mayor, and I commend his initiative and Councillor McPherson and others, is to keep all three as vibrant, vital performing groups for the benefit of this community and to acknowledge the incredible public good all three of them do, particularly for the younger people in this community. Personally, if I'm sitting on the board of Rivoli, yes, in the end I agree with Councillor Wilson, yes, I would actually ultimately want to own the land. So without that, I will be, in view of this latest communication from the board, I will certainly be supporting the King Forsyth motion.
Right, any other speakers for or against? Might make some comments. In September last year, when we made this resolution, we had almost exactly the same conversation then as we had today. And at that time, it was known that they wished to expand and invest in their buildings and their theatre, and that in order to do that, they needed land to give surety about how they could raise money. So nothing that has been discussed today is any different to what we discussed back then. The thing that's got it all muddled up is we've continued to have that conversation. And Councillor Wilson is absolutely right that they've not caused any confusion, certainly in who's communicating, but we're the ones that have caused all the confusion. The Rivoli Theatre want to buy the land because they want to get on with their plans. And in order to do that, they need surety and certainty. Discussions were held, as councillors know, with the Clarence Street people about them moving to Clarence Street. And that was ongoing for about a month or so as to whether that was a good option for them. And they decided not to do that because they wanted to stay put and expand their footprint. So, I mean, it's just been a long-winded discussion about everything that we talked about in September. We've got a sale and purchase agreement that's been signed, which is an offer. It's just an absolute no-brainer to me. Just accept the offer and get on with it. And the best we can do is absolutely, as Councillor Gallagher says, support them in their endeavours. And so I take it, Councillor Gallagher, that you will be attending the fundraising event.
Yes, and I invite you and everyone else to do that. Certainly. I would never turn down John and Glenice.
Good to hear. All right, so, the other comment I'd like to make is I think the inequities has just been another thing to muddy the waters. One good thing about Rivoli is they're 10 years in advance of everyone else, and they've been able to demonstrate that when you put facilities in the hands of those who know about them, you can be successful, and they've had 10 years to show us that. So hopefully the other two will catch up. So, Deputy Mayor, since you moved the motion, do you want to write a reply? No?
I can't withdraw it, can I?
No.
Yes,
if we all vote to, but...
You just vote.
Just for the...
of course we can withdraw.
The amendment needs to be voted down before you can...
No, rubbish. We can withdraw the moving and seconding of the motion at this stage.
Guys,
of course you can.
If you guys had let me speak, yes, you can, because as Mary told us, there's a process you can go through to do that. The question was is whether we just simply...
Hang on, your worship. I withdraw my seconding of the resolution. Boom.
I don't have to keep seconding it.
So Mary read out the rule, so perhaps we'll get her to read it out again.
You cannot be forced to continue moving or seconding
the
resolution.
So, Mary, would you like to read out the rule once the debate has started? Because there's a process once the debate has started.
And Standing Order 3.7.5, once motions or amendments have been seconded and put to the meeting by the chairperson, they cannot be withdrawn without the consent of the majority of the members present and voting. A motion to which an amendment has been moved and seconded can only be withdrawn if the amendment is withdrawn or lost.
If that's the case, Your Worship, we've been doing that for good, ever since you've been mayor anyway, and long before, not just because of you.
So we're following what's in the standing order, so that's clear?
Yep.
So now we're going to vote on the amendment.
So you now need to vote on the amendment.
Right. Okay, we're voting on the amendment.
Just delays them, but people change their mind.
Hang on, I just got a text from Lois.
Gary, you don't know how to do text.
The amendment is carried 12 votes to 1.
Your Worship, I think Leo may... May wish.
Hello.
But the amendment becomes a motion anyway, so you're going to have a chance.
I can't read the bloody thing up here.
It says yes and no, Leo.
Yeah, I know, but it was the amendment.
Sorry, councillors, we're going to re-vote on the amendment.
Yep.
And the amendment is the staff recommendation to proceed with the sale.
Yep.
So we're going to vote again on the amendment.
Yeah. We're on board.
The amendment is carried unanimously.
So we're now going to vote on the amendment as the motion. So it's now the motion and we're going to vote.
The motion is carried unanimously.
Thank you very much. Okay, councillors, we've got the next item, which is on page 58, which is the Ferry Bank Development Plan Design Brief. Thank you, Jacob. Okay, so Jake, would you like to introduce the report and...
Yep, sure. Good afternoon, Your Worship and councillors. I've put before you a Ferry Bank Development Plan design brief for your approval. Once this design brief is approved, it will be used as the basis of a request for expressions of interest for urban design and other services for the development of the Ferry Bank Development Plan, which is explained in the attached design brief. I'm happy to take questions.
Okay, thank you. Now, are there any questions, councillors? So I just have a query on page 67. I wonder if the 2.2 should be 2.3?
Yes, you're right about that, Your Worship.
That was that's right, isn't it?
Yep.
Okay. All right. So, no question? Yes, Councillor King, have a question?
Why are we going to the public with the development plan as though anyone's work could proceed through when in fact that's not reality?
Sorry, just for clarification, are you asking about the staged process in that we are going to call for qualified design companies and the like to submit their CVs to us? Is that the process you're talking about?
Now my concern is with step one, where it is as though anybody could be involved, the public could be involved.
I think you're looking at page 63, 2.1. Is that where you're looking at,
yeah.
Councillor King?
Yep. It has the feel of a public design competition, right, when in fact it's not.
So what the expression of interest does, the words open to everyone could have been perhaps better placed, and it's easily to change that to open to all qualified firms. The tender evaluation panel will then select three of them. When we talk about that this process will be delivered or run like a design competition, what we mean is that the shortlisted works will be publicly exhibited. That's the difference between a process that's run like a design competition and just a regular open tender where we would pick one firm to just do the work. So I'm quite happy that on page number 63, 2.1, number 1, reads expression of interest open to all qualified design groups.
Would it be better to say open to suitably qualified or something? I think Councillor King raises a good point. It looks like it's open to anyone to do a drawing.
That's right, and it's not the intention of the project team that we want, you know, Mar and Pa to submit a nice story or picture about what they want. This is a serious project.
So, Councillor King, are you suggesting perhaps that wording does need to be fixed?
Yeah, I think at the moment it could mislead.
Yeah.
And you could end up with schools getting involved and kids and, you know, yeah. I just think it's...
Okay, so open to, what did you say, Jake?
Suitably qualified design companies or suitably qualified firms.
Yeah.
It's actually it's a multidisciplinary team that we would be procuring. This is a mixture of urban design services.
So should that say suitably qualified applicants or something? Because, I mean, firms and people and multi,
yep.
you know, yep, could be misinterpreted as well, eh? Yeah, okay. All right, Councillor Mallett, question?
I have more questions.
Oh, sorry.
Mm-hmm. It's an indication in here about groups amalgamating into one enhanced, modernised building. And I'm just aware that some of these clubs have been there for in excess of 100 years. Some of the clubs are fierce rivals, and some of the clubs are into totally different types of sports. Have you had discussions with the clubs to get their feeling about this? At a board level where they can make decisions?
Through your worship, that's a very good point you raise, Councillor King. We do have clubs, particularly the Hamilton Rowing Club and the Waikato Rowing Club, have been located at this area for 114 years and 60 odd years respectively. And they are fiercely rival clubs. We are seeking through this design brief to show that the concept of co-location of some facilities is something that we're looking for. We think that would be an advantage in the area. We have had ongoing conversations, I would say probably every 4 or 5 months over the last 2 years, myself and others from council, and on occasion Her Worship the Mayor also, have met with stakeholders, including those clubs at the highest levels, their presidents and secretaries, and had ongoing discussions about where this work is heading. So there's no surprises in here for those clubs. This has been well signalled. The outcome of the design process is not known. You know, any scenario that you could imagine in terms of reallocation of clubs or spaces or buildings is, I guess, potential. That's why we're actually wanting to have qualified and suitably qualified teams sit down with all the relevant information and put forward concepts for the council and for the evaluation panel and for the public, ultimately, to share their views on.
What's their response to these clubs? I mean, you've told them, but what are they telling you?
Well, we have had conversations with these clubs over a long period of time, and they understand the motivation behind what council's trying to achieve. Obviously, clubs would be concerned if their homes were affected in a negative way, and also clubs would be excited if the opportunity to have improved facilities was an outcome of this process. So I would say that the responses we have had have been a mixture of apprehension about the future and excitement.
Do we have the right to move them off?
So all of the clubs on the Ferrybank area and the Roost Commerce Park area are leases on land held subject to the Reserves Act. There are leases that go to different periods of time. At the conclusion of those leases, clubs could be moved if that was the wish of council. We manage the land, and in most cases the buildings are owned by clubs. However, the way those leases are organised is such that if council wanted to move them, we could at the conclusion of their leases.
There's talk of supplementary reports on geotechnic flood risks. Where are these reports?
So these reports have been pulled together as part of the project team's due diligence on this project. Are a mixture of existing information which is held by council or has been developed by council during preparation of the district plan, and also we have had a couple of small desktop reports or desktop research exercises undertaken into some of the main risks associated with those sites, such as geotechnical constraints and significant archaeological sites. These are important documents to make available to any design team so that they have a full picture of the site that they're dealing with.
Shouldn't we be briefed on that before we make a $250,000 decision as council, so we know what we're... If you're privy to those reports already, shouldn't we have some sort of brief on them? It's quite important reports.
I'm more than happy to make those reports available to the council. I would say that the reports do not contain, at least to my mind, great surprises. A lot of what is known about the archaeological significance of that site has been well documented by previous reports that have been presented to council over years. The findings of the geotechnical reports are largely that, you know, the best areas to construct around this precinct are the areas where there are currently structures. And then these reports map out the sort of geotechnical features of land that show that there could be issues in certain areas, like this area has got a serious slope or a concave shape to it, which might show that there's some issue below the land. These reports, to my mind, do not raise any massive red flags or concerns or information that council wouldn't have assumed to be the case. And that said, I'm very happy to make those reports available to councillors.
I think it would have been good to have a brief on those in this report, not full reports, but just a steer to help us make a decision. You're talking in the report about extra parking. Is it proposed that we're going to lose more parking green space to get the extra parking?
What is simply proposed in the design brief is that on and off street parking is a consideration of the design teams that undertake this development plan. There's no assumptions made about increases or decreases in particular at this point.
And your brief talks about a commercial mixed development, cafes and restaurants. Does the Reserves Act status of the land let commercialisation of a park happen for usages outside of the use of the park? Because we're talking about this aligning with the city centre, we're talking about commercial opportunities. This appears to me to be far bigger than what would be, say, down at Hamilton Gardens, where the shop sells trinkets associated with the gardens, and the shop sells coffee and a slice or an ice cream to be consumed there, and people wouldn't go there as a destination. That would be part of their experience.
So
I'm just trying to get my head around how...
Councillor King, you raise again very valid points, and I've got a couple of comments to make about that. The land area which we are talking about is a mixture of public parks held subject to the Reserves Act 1977, of current and stopped roads, and also of municipal endowment property. So there are a range of different land classifications in that area, and different things can happen on different parts of land. That you are right that any development of, for instance, a cafe would need to go through a Reserves Act process, would need to include potentially a change to a Reserves Act management plan. There is the possibility for some related commercial activity on reserves that are related to the use of the park. And as you say, the Hamilton Gardens is a good example. So is the Curran Ladbrook offering at the Ferrybank Lounge. All of that happens on reserve property. However, the Ferrybank Development Plan presents an opportunity in the municipal endowment property in this area, which is a very different kettle of fish compared to reserve land. So that's the land around the municipal pool. That's municipal endowment land.
So the commercial opportunities won't happen on the reserve land?
It is possible that commercial opportunities can happen on reserve land. They have to go through a process. There are constraints on those commercial activities. There are far less constraints on commercial activities happening on municipal endowment property, as you've seen around the city, where the council has been involved in developments.
How many of the trees on the site are protected?
There are, I don't have the number on top of my head, but it's all listed in the district plan. There are a number of protected trees. When you look at the ferry bank, if you asked an average person on the street in Hamilton about the trees at ferry bank, they would think of the large oak trees that are around the road at Grantham Street. They are, I believe, all protected trees in the district plan. There is a process. If you wanted to remove a protected tree from the district plan, you would do that through a district plan variation.
The thoughts that we might be removing trees?
This has got nowhere near that level of detail. I'm merely explaining the process for how that would occur. There are a number of protected trees throughout that area. I would say that the design teams who undertake this work would need to consider the public's feeling about those sorts of things as part of their design. And that's why, in part, we want to have a process where you have three design teams that put out three different concepts. So the public, all of the stuff will be in the papers, and the public will be able to let us know which direction they feel most comfortable with.
And I see the brief includes two walking bridges with cycling and cafes and commercial development. Have you any idea of what the cost of this finished development is going to be?
The brief asks the design team to consider the location of a pedestrian bridge, one, and what that means to the design team will be in their mind. It could be additions to existing bridges. They could recommend no pedestrian bridge, or they could recommend pedestrian bridge in this specific location. Again, the design brief is not at that level of specifying where a bridge should go or what it should be like.
So have you got any idea what this finished project's going to cost?
We couldn't. The development that may or may not occur at Ferrybank as a result of the master plan could vary quite significantly depending on where the plan lands. So it would be extremely difficult to guess the scale of development that would occur at this area before the process has been undertaken, the design process.
And where's the money going to come from?
For the design process?
No, for the build.
Well, there are a range of options. Again, because we've got municipal endowment property at play here, obviously there are options associated with that. This is the sort of thing that could be hypothetically developed by council or aspects of it developed by others.
So we're thinking possibly of using the municipal endowment fund.
What I mean to say was that because you have land in this area which is municipal endowment property, that in itself provides opportunities to partner with private sector to develop a part of this plan. I'm not suggesting to this council that they need to take any specific block of funds and spend it. I'm saying that we've got municipal endowment property as part of this site, and that presents opportunities.
And did this council make a submission recently to central government to try and streamline legislative procedures around revoking or making it easier to take land out of the Reserves Act status?
I'm not aware. That's not something I've been involved in. Some other general manager or chief executive may wish to comment.
Yes, I think we did.
What are the thoughts of the environmental side of Tainui? Not the commercial arm, but the environmental arm, about this project?
Our relationship with Waikato Tainui on this project is via their officers, their chief executive, and we are having ongoing conversations with them about this project. They've had input to this brief. They were partners, obviously, in developing the river plan. So
what part of Tainui is that?
The
tribal part, not the commercial part, but for example, I've had discussions with Parakafia in terms of her view as chief executive of the tribal part in respect of their support or otherwise. And she did review the design brief as well, and their staff provided feedback on the design brief also.
And then when Richard talks about the staff, he's talking about the environmental strategic staff. We're not talking about the development arm of the tribe. We're talking about the tribal office.
Yep. A few years ago, the rowing club tried to increase the size of their building, and it was, I understand it was opposed by Tainui quite strongly. Can you fill us in on the background of what happened there?
I cannot, because I'm not privy to the details of what happened at that time.
Is Brian here?
And
would Brian know, or Deborah?
My recollection, Councillor King, is that you're correct, that there was opposition either at an officer level at council or from Waikato Tainui about expansion of the footprint in that case. That's my recollection. One of the objectives of the Ferrybank development plan is to sit down with Waikato Tainui on this journey and to work out a plan for this precinct that meets the future aspirations of the tribe and of council, so that we can have some methods to overcome those sorts of disputes and work through them. That's where the potential in this to realise a greater use of that site is really by going with Waikato Tainui from the beginning, so we don't get to a point where they say, oh, we don't like this or we want that. So I think we're doing the right things at the moment to maximise the greatest chance of success for council, both by engaging at an officer level and a political level. Tomorrow, Mayor Hardacre and I are presenting to the board of Waikato Tainui, Te Ara Taura, on the river plan. Those sorts of engagements is what's being carried on and started throughout this process. But it is precisely this sort of issue that you just raise that has hindered development in the past, and which we hope to overcome by following an open, transparent and collaborative process.
Deborah, have you got anything to add to that on a planning side?
No.
It just seems crazy to me that 3 years ago they wouldn't let us expand, or a few years ago, the footprint, and now they're letting us...
Councillor, that was a slightly different issue, and it had to do with under the Reserves Act rather than the district plan. So the rowing club has a resource consent to expand, but the issue was under the Reserves Act and the right of first refusal, and that's where it has sat until this time. So it's not a district.
So, under the Reserves Act, if we couldn't do anything or can't do anything now, how can all of a sudden under the Reserves Act we can
perhaps Lance can
do a full commercial or a part commercial development?
Through you, Worship, the discussion was council staff advised the rowing club about the first right of refusal issue under the Treaty Settlement Act, and a number of discussions and as Deborah said, that really it was parked up, knowing that there would be some potential planning for that area in the future, whether that was through a Reserves Act Management Plan review, and then the river plan came along. So really the rowing club was advised of the complexities of trying to expand their footprint on that site. So the rowing club, being the organisation it is, actually took that advice in hand and then said, let's wait and see what transpires through the planning processes and be involved in that process going forward. So it wasn't Tainui jumping in and actually saying, we're going to stop this straight away. It was actually council officers advising the rowing club of what the complexities of the situation were going forward.
So how are we...
So the way watch, that that's...
Watch change.
The way that we would seek to resolve those situations is that we do a Ferrybank development plan. As part of that, the follow-up actions from the development plan will will possibly be a district plan variation and potentially and a review and potentially changes to our Riverside Reserves Management Plan. So it's that Riverside Reserves Management Plan that that sort of stipulates how that reserve can be used, and that's the opportunity where we would perhaps seek to make some changes in that space.
Thank you.
Councillor Mallett?
Just telling my wife where I am. Thank you. Thank you very much. Item 24, paragraph 24, we talk about the budget plan is for $200,000. That's the, I've added all those things up. Just to be quite clear, that that $200,000 is covered in all of these things on pages 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, is that right? So to get a plan up to stage three development plan.
That's correct.
Okay. And that's all council funding?
That's correct, as signalled through the 10-year plan.
Yep, okay. Have you tried to raise any money from Tiny? Have Tiny suggested they might help or anything like that?
This is Hamilton City Council wants to be the client in this exercise.
Okay.
So we have chosen to go down this course of action and use the budget available we have through the river plan in the 10-year plan.
Okay. Why have you chosen the sort of this contest process rather than the normal sort of request for proposal, tender, people put their things in?
We have actually spent some time examining the options for how we could deliver this, how we could procure the services for this project, including all of the variations that you just alluded to. And we are going through a formal tender process through our proper e-tender processes. The only difference here is that rather than immediately selecting one firm, we're having a stage two, where we are going to select three firms and have them produce a high-level concept plan. The purpose of that is really to have a contest of ideas in the community about how to best use the most significant prime piece of public river-facing land in the city, and the public engagement benefits of having a tender process that has that publicity component and exhibition of ideas, which is really of no significant cost to council to have that feature, but delivers a huge added advantage that if we just went straight to tender, appointed someone and got them to do the work, the public wouldn't be able to experience some different concepts, and we might have some stuff come through that concept planning stage that challenges assumptions, that gets public conversation going. Those benefits are why we have selected this procurement method.
So is the expectation that it'll be, and I won't have the right words here, but that it'll be qualified planners, designers, architects, engineers who are doing this stuff? It's not, you're not asking Standard 4 at Barden Primary School to come up with their ideas, obviously.
No. In our evaluation criteria for stage one, Gary.
A lot cheaper, yeah.
In our evaluation criteria for stage one, we look at the CVs of those involved, the track record of those involved. They have to pitch a vision for the site. We are talking about the serious players in this country who would do these sorts of services, and we have had a high level of interest in being involved in this project from the sorts of players you would expect to see in a project of this significance for the city.
Okay, so the $200,000 of paragraph 24 is from our 10-year plan.
It's the year one. It's from the year one river plan budget in the 10-year plan.
And that was all for this type of stuff. It wasn't for building things. It was for planning and consultation.
The 10-year plan money was for a range of things, including this sort of activity.
But none of it was for building for bricks and mortar, was it? And roads and bridges and pathways.
Well, that level of specificity wasn't listed. Yeah. It was rather that these are the sorts of examples of projects that we would undertake with this budget, and it might be a mixture of some capital investment in smaller projects, and operational money spend on the sort of planning and design services we need to get projects ready to either partner with externals or to actually seek further external funding.
And there are lots of challenges we're going to face. Andrew asked about the rowing clubs. You said there's some tenure there. What is their tenure? How long have they got?
There's different lease arrangements. And again, off the top of my head, they range I think one of those clubs at least might end in 2021. Another one might end in 2026. Again, I'm just...
Those are roughly where that you think they are?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. And then the process from here, if this gets approved, and then... is there a timeline? Sorry, I haven't seen a timeline in here.
Yep.
Oh, sorry, yes it is. July 2016.
Yep.
Okay. So that's the concept, the plan, that's the DVDs or whatever you call it?
That's the detailed development plan, fully finished, loaded, given to the council to adopt, which then drives district plan variation.
Okay,
it's the finished product.
So what level of plan is that? Could you build a building off that? Of what they were going to get?
What this exercise is not what you'd call a design and build. It's not designing buildings.
Yeah.
It's designing the use of space and the areas in those.
So places. We had those Australian guys came over and we did that, and they did those photos with the dad walking around with a 3-year-old on his shoulder and someone with a skateboard and that sort of stuff.
So those were high level concepts to communicate an aspiration to the community to show the sort of thing we want to do.
Yeah.
We're now drilling down to the next level where we actually say this building that performs this function, which will be broadly this size, will be in this position.
Okay, so this is real now, eh?
Yes.
Is that right? So that, but it's not the, there's no quote for the price of the building thrown in there. No,
so the buildings won't necessarily be designed.
Okay.
The council can, along the way, undertake some QS work on concepts to make sure that, you know, there's some reality there.
Okay.
But no, it's not a, we won't have buildings designed.
So we're expecting that at that point that because someone's thought there should be a building there, there will also, the geotech work would have been done as well to confirm it can go there.
So there's some initial geotechnical work undertaken to give people a steer.
Yep.
There will need to be presumably further work. Again, as you'll know, when you think of a development, there's certain work you can do. When you start a development, there's even more work you need to do.
Yep.
So it's on a journey, and we feel that we've sort of got the right amount of information for the stage in the project we're at.
So I'm just trying to figure out what we get for our $200,000. That won't have... You won't have tenants there. You won't have the building or the architect. No architect would have designed a building for you. It'll just be a concept that there'll be a building here. There'll be a coffee area here. There'll be a
so the purpose of this
playground here.
The purpose of this plan is to understand spatially where things will go, so that we can draw a line in the sand. The council can then sign up to that and say, look, this is what we now need to move forward on, and that will be used as a basis to enable the regulatory environment, so then we can start doing deals.
I guess my concern of this is that in the scale of things, and don't quote me on this, $200,000 is not all that much. Sometimes it's a lot, but for the scale of what we're doing down there, this is a small amount. But I just find it's so conceptual that I'm not too sure how the hell I know you've delivered or not, or how the heck we know we got value for our $200,000 or not, or can we go forward with this or not. You know, how many more $100,000 of work has to be done before we can even put things out to the market to say, okay, guys, you tell us who's going to buy.
I guess the answer to that question is we are looking for a product that is sufficient to drive a plan change. So that's quite important, because currently the Ferrybank zone has got a destination open space zoning. That zoning may not be sufficient to deliver or permit the sort of scale of mixed use commercial or future. It might not be sufficient to get where we want to be in the future. So this process needs to give us enough information, evidence, that we can then set forward on that plan change process. So I guess that's what success looks like in one respect.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
just to signal, I'm happy to move the resolution.
Any other questions? Yes, Councillor Forsyth.
I just wonder, in the development plan detail expected at stage 3, that if we could make some reference to our city plans. I know there's some bullet point references to riverwalks, cycleways, Tower River Ride, green spaces, etc. But if we had something like reference and alignment with principles and priorities and direction of our biking plan, playground plan, heritage plan, youth plan, older persons. I think that would... I just think it's a little bit general, and if we we tie that in more directly, then I think we keep the integrity of our other strategic city plans rather than a loose reference.
So is that something along the lines of expected considered alignment with relevant council strategies and plans? Is that
Not so much strategies, but
And I have a place where that could be inserted on page 63 at the top. It's right at the at the end of the context section. So at the moment it says acknowledging the history, heritage, uses and cultural significance of the site. We could then say comma and the strategies of the Hamilton City Council will play an important role in the formation of the development plan.
Yeah, there are more plans and strategies. We don't, I mean, I'm just using the words that we're using here, but we call them plan and heritage plan and older persons plan, youth plan, because they will, I mean, that's an area that's really going to link and affect all of those.
And absolutely, Councillor Forsyth, that that is, I guess, an intention of this plan. I guess there is another section on page 64 where it says designs must cater for the vision and direction of the council found within the River Plan, the Hamilton Plan, the proposed district plan. And you could put there, and other plans. And if you wanted to go further, such as?
Yes, I'd like those, because if they're not there in black and white and somebody picks up this kind of brief and sees the word plans, I mean, I don't think that's detailed enough.
Sure, so we're talking here about a bike plan.
Biking plan, playground plan, heritage plan, youth plan, older persons. There's already reference to the Central City Transformation Plan.
Dog plan? Dog plan?
Do we have a dog?
Yeah. Library plan?
Yeah, I mean, my suggestion would be to have designs must cater to the vision and strategic direction of council and not list every plan that the council has.
The policies and plans are our strategy. 10-year plan.
I think what Councillor Forsyth's looking for is certainty that the potential applicants for this are aware of those particular planning documents. And so that's the... She's looking for that surety.
I'm happy to include whatever wording the council wishes in that respect.
Okay.
It means that when they pick that up, they say, "Oh, there is a heritage plan, or there is a biking plan. I need to go and find that."
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah. Right. Absolutely. Any other questions, Councillor Young?
Just a quick one. On page 59, point 24, last bullet point, $5,000 for travel and accommodation costs. So are you intended to have the panel member from overseas or out of Hamilton?
So on the tender evaluation panel, there are a number of New Zealand-based experts, one from Christchurch, one from Wellington. So they would. We're not offering to pay these people. We are offering to get them to Hamilton and house them while they're undertaking that duty. And that's what that budget line is for.
Should we be sorting those people from Hamilton first? Or?
Well, there is a mixture of expertise on that group, including some people from Hamilton.
Okay, any other questions? So, councillors, I move the recommendation on page 58, but I do want to suggest a couple of additional
discounts.
The first is that B should read that the Ferrybank Development Plan Design Brief with discussed amendments. And councillors, I'm intending to add into the motion the inclusion of two elected people on the tender evaluation panel, and the membership is in 2.4. And I have discussed with Councillor Gallagher that I would include myself and him in that group. And I'm happy to speak to that and why. As part of the motion. So the motion would be A and B, that the Ferrybank Development Plan Design Brief with amendments and with the inclusion of two elected members being the Mayor and Councillor Gallagher be included on the tender evaluation panel is approved. So if you could
Sounds
add those.
To me, I'll second that.
Councillor Wilson has seconded that, and I'm happy now to speak to it. I'll speak particularly first to that point. Councillor Gallagher and I have been on the journey since day one with this river plan, and so has Councillor O'Leary. One of the things that I feel is missing in the assessment of the designs and the publicness of it is the input of, I guess, the aspirations and what it means to live here in this community and how much that development means. And while I absolutely respect the need for the technical experts, there's no doubt about that, I think what is missing is the sort of the community side, I guess. And if you look at the expected criteria about livability, which is on page 65, 2.5.4, and then over the page about distinction and innovation, which are also matters that this plan needs to take into account. Those are things that are really about our city and how our city will be in the future, and I think it is important that we have some input into that process. Certainly the council's going to have touch points as these designs come back for sign-off, but I think at the coalface is critical, and Councillor Gallagher kindly said that he would be happy to come on that with me, and I want to thank him for that. So that's the reasoning behind that.
Is that taking the Chief Executive's nominee?
No.
Oh, so
this is an addition. So this would be, instead of 5 members, it would make it 7 members. So with the addition of 2 elected people. Yeah, he would still have a nominee option. And that might be himself, because I think, you know, there's a role there for technical expertise from staff. So I'm also going to speak just generally about what this is about. I think there are several important things about the decision today, and I would encourage councillors to support this motion. Yes, there's lots of questions to ask about what is it going to look like, how much is it going to cost, is it going to have a pedestrian bridge, where is everything going to go? This is the plan that will decide that. And for those of us who have been on the River Group who have read all of the reports, all we know is that they've all stalled and never quite got going. And today is about signing off to get going and actually realising what we want to do down there for the river and for the city. So I think it's a pretty important thing. One of the things that became very obvious to us when we were developing the river plan, particularly on the day that we had the Meteor Public Day, and we had the images up and there was a lot of talk, and more people came to that public consultation process than had come to a council consultation process for years. And what became really, really clear is that the public want to see and want to be involved in what happens and how it looks. It's really, really important. And so I'm really pleased that the staff have come back with a process that, while, you know, it's got all the robustness around tenders and procurement, it's also got a public element, because I think it's absolutely critical that we ensure the public can see what's happening and can see the ideas that are being generated and can voice a view about those. Because at the end of the day, it's the people in the city that are going to use the place and live here and want to be part of it. So I'm really pleased that this process, Jake, and I know you've done an awful lot of work and tested an awful lot of expert minds about the best way to go about this, and I want to thank you for that, because I actually think what you've landed is really, really good. So thanks for that. So I'd really encourage councillors to get going. This is our chance to finally do something, and I think it's pretty momentous. Anyone else want to speak? Yes, Councillor Kane.
I'm speaking against this motion. Our local iwi originally occupied this land, and it's ended up in reserve as a park. This was to protect this land from commercial opportunities and commercial development, which is exactly what this report is indicating will happen as part of this redevelopment. There are large protected trees on this land that have significance to our past. The land in this area is unstable and floods. As a minimum, before we make a decision, we should have the reports or a briefing on the reports on stability, on flood risk, archaeological, what it will cost and where the money will come from. Certainty is needed on the legality of the proposal to make this a commercial opportunity on reserve land before we start spending money. What are the changes to the roading? Are we going to lose green space to parking? We already have a struggling city centre, and if this becomes a commercial opportunity, as it's proposed, it may weaken our city centre further. I'm all about connecting our city with the river, but past generations knew what they were doing when they set our city up at the height they did and the distance that they did back from the riverbank, because it's unstable and it does flood. We already own as a council three large undeveloped pieces of land in Hamilton's commercial centre. There's Sonnen Car Park, the Victoria on the river site, and the land behind the Arts Post. All these pieces of land are zoned appropriately for the park commercial mixed-use development which is proposed for the ferry bank, but without the complications of the Reserves Act. They all run onto the river reserve, have fantastic views, and will connect our city with the river. This won't weaken our city retail centre or fragment it further by introducing a new area into our city centre. Hamilton City already has high vacancy rates, and it is considered by some to be oversized for our population. Staff and management here at council have sacrificed a lot with redundancies, restructuring, and working beyond the call of duty, which could have affected their personal lives, relationships, their health, or worse, because of overspending by elected members on pet projects. Some of you are in this room. The ratepayers have had a continual compounding 3.8% rate rise when the cost of living is below 1%. And 1 year recently, there was an 8% rate rise. And at the same time, the ratepayers have had to suffer a reduced level of service. These sacrifices, combined with elected members not pursuing pet projects since the Claudins and the V8s, has brought our city debt down remarkably from a forecasted $440 million to around about $370 million today. We may have voted to increase debt to nearly $500 million in the 10-year plan just 1 month ago by the slimmest of majorities, but this didn't include money for the river plan needed on the scale that this document proposes. Now we are being presented with what I believe is another pet project, the redevelopment of the ferry bank. This is the beginning of spending on a massive scale to commercialise a reserve set aside by previous generations for future generations. As an elected member, I'm not prepared to stand by and let this happen on my watch. This is wrong on so many levels. Please stop this today with a no vote.
Okay, thank you. Any other speakers? Yes, Councillor Mallett.
Thanks. Similar concerns to Andrew. I see this as the thin end of the wedge, the camel's nose under the tent, and the Trojan horse. Three little analogies there. Wow. Camel's nose under the tent. Haven't you ever heard of that one?
No.
You need to read a bit more. What we're doing here is... we are opening the doors to a huge... This is our V8's moment. This is our Claudelands moment. We are opening the doors to a huge deluge of public spending public money. And I would be very, very supportive of this if it was limited to us simply pulling back from that area, reducing planning regulations in that area, creating the infrastructure, but we will not do that. What will happen is we will be the builder, we will be the owner, we will do everything we are not good at, and this will not end well. The count, as Andrew said eloquently before, the council has done a good job in the last 3 or 4 years in reducing debt. We've got some problems with that in terms of our rates, increasing our rates, which, as he said, going well above CPI. But this, I'm sure, will be the first step in the road to fiscal ruin for this council.
Thank you. Councillor McPherson?
Yes, I agree with much of what the last
two speakers have said, I would love the riverbank to be redeveloped, and I think Jacob and others have done some good work, good conceptual work and thinking, but I can't in all conscience support spending $200,000 or even $250,000 that's in the LTP or anything, in fact, on planning for what does amount to some grandiose spending plans further down the line, and maybe not that much further down the line. When this council, at the same time, has cut spending on what I regard as some very important community and social services, obviously not everyone's cup of tea, but if you're going to hack into those areas and spend in this area, which is a nice to have, then I think your priorities are wrong. Andrew also mentioned staff redundancies. People are hurt because of that, and not just the people who lost their jobs, but it can be families, and it can be the communities around them as well. And, you know, I don't want to wax too lyrical about this, I'll leave that to Gary and Andrew, but I certainly don't know about camel's nose under the tent.
I'll explain it to you.
Okay, thanks. But, look, it seems to me that it's 4 years since the V8s now, and we've lost the institutional knowledge already, which does surprise me. That's quicker than in the past. That train wreck that was the V8s and Claudelands, we're just setting the train in motion again, guys. Have a look what happens, what these sorts of plans lead into. And, you know, I wouldn't mind that if I felt we could afford it. I'm listening to all the talk about how we can't afford things that I regard as higher priorities, and yet we want to have the bread and circuses, which is what this is. So I think you've got your priorities wrong to support this. It would be lovely to have Councillor Gallagher on that committee deciding the direction on things. He'd be sort of happy as Larry to do that. But is that a priority for council? That's my concern. I don't think it is.
Thank you, Councillor Leary.
Thank you. It seems that every time we discuss this plan, we end up debating and hearing the same things, and I'm talking about pet projects, Councillor King and several other things. But it's the first time I've heard the vision of this river plan for the city being described as a fiscal ruin. And I just... how you can take a position on something as significant as this and say that it's fiscal ruin is, it's actually humorous to me. It's humorous because this isn't a pet project. This is simply, let me put it simply, this is a strategy for the city, and this is a strategy that the city wants. It's a vision. This plan, yes, there's a big price tag on this plan, but this is important to get this one right. And it is what the residents want. This is, come on, people, this is not the V8s. This is not going to take us down the road of fiscal ruin. And just for the record, the financial plan that we are achieving was put in place by the previous council. In actual fact, it was put in place by the start of the current mayor's term. And congratulations to this council, at the current council, for sticking to that plan. But at this, the work and the results that we are achieving at the moment of that plan were put in place by the previous council. So those members on that council need to be acknowledged for that work. Let me remind the members around the table about strategy and vision, particularly for a city, and I know that the right members around the table, those that sit far right, will say leave it to the public sector. Yeah, okay, whatever, fine. But the residents want this, and it's our job when we're elected to look after their interests. And look, they want it, they want it, they want it. They've waited 25 years for members around this table to have the kahunas to get on with it.
And hopefully
the majority of us have that. It's not a pet project. It's not going to be fiscal ruin. Have we not just received $2.5 million for a garden for our gardens. Have we not just received that? Why did we receive that? Because we had a vision and we put that vision out there and we nailed that vision. Have we not just got 3.5 for cycling? $3.5 million. What's that? $6 million in the last few weeks. $6 million for two visions. The strategies, the plans, two visions, $6 million. I'm still waiting for money for doggies, but we'll get there. What else have we got? Playgrounds. Hundreds of thousands of dollars have been donated in the last several years for playgrounds. Why? Because, wow, we had a vision. We put it out there. If you think that this river plan is going to fiscally ruin this council and this city, you are crazy. But what you can bank is that money will come. When we put this vision out there, and it's going to have to be splendid, and with Councillor Gallagher and the Mayor on there and the executive team, whoever's going to be deciding on this panel, I have no doubt in my mind that it will be splendid. But believe you me, the money will come. If we can get $6 million for gardens and cycling, we can get a lot more for a river plan. Because remember, it's not often, I'm getting quite loud, aren't I, which is very unusual for me, taking a leaf out of my colleague, Councillor Gallagher. There is very little opportunity around this kind of development in the country, let alone anywhere in the world, where you have greenfield opportunities for developers beside a river. Once in a lifetime opportunity, so get with the program, give the residents of the city what they want and see the vision and support this, because the millions of dollars that we're going to benefit and that this residents are going to benefit from, that to me is a no-brainer.
Thank you. Any other speakers for or against? Councillor Wilson?
Yes, Your Worship. Look, I can understand Councillor McPherson's concern. His is one simply driven by what he gleans to be inequity, that there have been cuts in some areas, and those cuts, in my opinion, have been very unfortunate. However, my concern is that by simply not supporting this initiative on the basis of other decisions, I don't know if the ratepayer would thank us for that. I think each of these issues have to be judged on their merit, and they have to be analysed in that context. And although I am no significant supporter of Her Worship, I recognise, and I have been consistent in my position when it comes to the river plan, and that is, the city has wanted it, the city has demanded it, the city has expected it, and the city has frequently been misled, been let down by those in the position to make a difference. And so I'm more than happy to put my frustration aside of some of the things that we've had to cut. I'm more than prepared to put my disappointment at the most recent annual budget, which I thought was wrong and goes back on what was promised. And I'm prepared to support the Mayor in a vision that I share with her. And that is, this is the beginning of something special. This is not a precursor to some economic downfall or Armageddon. That is a pitch by the far right when they've got nothing else to constructively put forward. This is about us laying the foundation, showing some leadership, showing some vision, and potentially spending some seed funding and seeing how it unfolds. And can I say this? if by some miracle that we do spend a little bit of too much money on this, unlike the V8s, this legacy will remain. This legacy will continue to pay dividends for generations. And maybe as a result of those dividends, just maybe as a result of those dividends, this city will continue to grow. And this city will continue to prosper. And that economic return may enable this council to reflect on some of its earlier decision to cut social spending. And maybe that will lead us to be able to repair and replace some of the cuts that have led to some of our frustration and the frustrations that Councillor McPherson has illustrated. But we do that by having a vision. And this is a good vision. And that's why I support Her Worship, and I'm happy to stand behind her on this point.
Thank you. Any other? Oh, Councillor Gallagher.
Yes. Obviously, I totally acknowledge the very valuable contribution for all members today. And if this motion goes through, I have a sense that there'll be at least four or five councillors who I will figuratively having sitting on the shoulder in terms of making sure that we do move ahead, but move ahead with caution. And we respect that this is not a unanimous view of this council. And we do learn and always remember the lessons from the past, and that we are really focused on what good local government and good urban government should be about. One of its core missions, in my view, for urban government is about good urban renewal. And just as we're trying to get a partnership in terms of renewing our CBD precinct, this to me is very clearly interlinked, and the motive is to have a good place to live and work and play, and to bring economic benefit to our communities. So any proposals got to stack in terms of the investor, in terms of the private sector wanting to come with us and other groups as well. If you look overseas, you look in this country, you look what's happening in Christchurch, albeit with huge central government funding because of their circumstances. You look at the Auckland waterfront, you look at the Wellington waterfront, you look at smaller examples with deep rivers like the city of Ipswich in Queensland, you look at large cities like Brisbane. All of those journeys had to start somewhere, and subject to proper management of those journeys, there's been huge economic benefit to those communities, and that's something that's important. If we take a small local example, I would invite you to cast your mind back to our beautiful lake 15 years ago when you couldn't walk around it. Mm-hmm. And there was opposition, lest we forget, to actually completing the walk around. I want you to cast your mind before the lake veranda restaurant was replaced, the previous structure. And I want you to now fast forward 10 or 20 years and go down there at 8 o'clock in the morning, which I do more or less most days, if I can, roughly. And I want you to notice the people. And I want you to notice the playground. And I want you to notice, in a sense, a degree of partnership in the sense of the private operators who run the veranda. It could be other models of that public-private partnership. I want you to look at the playground. I want you, most important, to look at the people now that are actually using that as a major venue. And the example previously of the Hamilton Gardens was used. And again, let's go back 30 years when it was the tip, when it was the dump. And I see this particular project in a similar context. The possible difference between this project and the other two projects I've talked about will, I think, be hopefully a greater private sector partnership. And I certainly look forward to, at the appropriate time, the philanthropic groups and other groups coming on board as well. I think also it's very, very important to note, and this is where I am very respectful that not all councillors clearly support this particular motion today,
but also look very importantly at items 2, page 64, that there is going to be the next step of endorsing a recommendation from the tender evaluation panel with regard to the final design team and the final adopt and sign-off of the development plan. So this, to a degree, is a train that leaves the station, yes, but there are a couple of very important station calls on the way where the train can literally be stopped, rerouted, whatever. All right? All you're doing today is you're obviously approving the a quantum spend for the first stage. The next stage has absolutely come back to this chamber, and there will be further rigorous debate around partnerships, around funding, etc., etc. This, respectfully, is not a signing a V8 type contract at all. But it is a good analogy to use in the sense that let's never forget when we get carried away by our enthusiasm. And I assure you, as a council and elected member, we always must remember those particular examples to ensure that the road ahead is one of degree of caution. But let's, in exercising caution, never lose a dream of what the city can truly become.
Thank you, Councillor Forsyth.
Thank you. Thank you, Councillor Gallagher. Well said. Caution and excitement, I might add. And look, I just want to revisit the origins of our world-famous Hamilton Gardens again. So, yes, back in the 1970s, it was a dog dosing strip and the city dump. And if it weren't for the vision of the leaders back then, we wouldn't have what we have today. But not only the vision of those leaders, but also the collaboration and partnerships with philanthropics, with central government and local businesses as well. So the same model is what we're going to be using now. This is about building partnerships. I want to thank Councillor O'Leary for highlighting and for reminding us about the recent significant successes of the External Funding Subcommittee and the very competent staff that work within that part of council, that show what can be achieved when people have a vision, people have support, and people know what they're doing and they do it well. I also want to thank those councillors around this table that do share a vision, that do have the ability to look forward, that have the fortitude and the leadership to support a design brief like this. So I'm thanking you in advance.
Okay, thank you. Any other speakers for or against? Right, we're going to the board. Vote.
Gary, wake up.
Don't worry, Gary. I had my finger on that button a long time ago.
That's the problem.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You broke it.
Press it again, Gary.
It's so hard.
Press. I'm pushing, baby, I'm pushing.
Try the other button.
The green one will work, Gary.
You want us to reset it?
Yeah.
We're going to reset it, everyone. So can you just take your fingers off? We're going to reset it.
Gary,
the light's
alone.
Going.
Take your finger
all right,
off.
All right, we're ready to go? Right, we're ready to go.
The motion's been carried, 9 votes to 4.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Jake, for all your work. My councillors, we're now moving to public excluded. So I'm going to move us into that, and I'm just going to ask councillors, do you want to take a 5-minute stretch break and grab
yes.
a drink?
Yes.
Yeah, and I am just putting in my apologies.
So, okay, so before we move into public excluded, let's do that first so they can deal with some. So I'll move that we go to public excluded, seconded by Councillor Young. Councillors, we're just...
Aye.
Right. Yes. Okay. Right.